I come from a land where words feel very heavy. I think every Turkish writer, journalist, novelist, poet, or academic knows that words can get one into trouble. We do know that because of a poem, a novel, a short story, or an article, we can be targeted, stigmatized by the government. We do know that we can be almost lynched on social media by trolls. We can perhaps be sued, put on trial, detained, arrested, or exiled, all because of words. So when we write, we carry this knowledge at the back of our minds. And as a result, there's widespread self-censorship among Turkey's literati. But I think this is a very difficult subject to talk about, because how do you talk about the kind of censorship that you internalize and that you carry within? It is embarrassing, but there is too much tension, too much intimidation, and too much polarization in Turkey. And this has been going on for a very long time. And whenever you bring these elements together, it means there is self-censorship. So overall, it's a very difficult habitat for us storytellers. But I also believe that if you happen to be a writer from wounded democracies, you do not have the luxury of being apolitical. And this is a dilemma for us, because normally, as writers, we are solitary creatures. What we do thrives upon solitude. We're like hermits, or perhaps like mystics. When we publish a book, we are catapulted into the public space. But otherwise, we like to stay in our own imaginary worlds, in our own storyland, which is a land without passports, without any borders. So I think it's challenging for introverted writers to turn into activists in the public space. But as I said, if you come from such lands like Turkey, Nigeria, Venezuela, Colombia, Tunisia, Egypt, you do not have the luxury of being apolitical, especially in places where politics is divisive, aggressive, oppressive. Writers and poets cannot close their eyes or shut their doors. Doris Lessing once very famously said that literature is analysis after the event. But I think more and more we feel the need that sometimes literature needs to be analysis during the event. Sometimes writers need to respond while things are happening and when countries going through the darkest tunnels. And such a country is my motherland, Turkey. Over the years, ultranationalism, Islamism, authoritarianism, and sexism have all been on the rise. Now, some people might think that these are completely disconnected processes, but in my opinion, they're deeply connected. So, in countries where authoritarianism escalates, nationalism also tends to rise. And when countries become more and more nationalistic, sexism also escalates. It is not a coincidence that as Turkey began to lose its democracy with a bewildering speed, violence against women also increased in Turkey. And all of these are happening under a government that has been in power for a very long time, for more than 14 years, under a government that has increasingly become more and more inward-looking and detached from Europe, a government that confuses democracy with majoritarianism. I think we need to make it very clear that these are completely different things. For a proper democracy to exist and to function, one needs more than the ballot box. You need rule of law, separation of powers, definitely a free and diverse media, an independent academia, women's rights, LGBT rights, and freedom of speech. Together with all these components, a democracy can thrive. If you don't have any of these elements, but only the ballot box, that system cannot be called a democracy. It can be at best called majoritarianism, but worse yet, it will become a very dark, dull, and dangerous form of authoritarianism. And today, Turkey has become the world's biggest jailer for journalists, surpassing even China's sad record. There are more than 150 journalists in prison. Among them, next to them, there are columnists, editors, literary editors, cartoonists. Thousands of academics have lost their jobs. And when I say they lost their jobs, we have to understand that these people have almost no chance of finding another job in another university, because once you are blacklisted, once you're stigmatized, that door is completely closed. And they have families. In a rule of law, under a rule of law, every human being is regarded as innocent until proven guilty. In Turkey, it is the other way around. It's topsy-turvy. Journalists are labeled as guilty, and then they're expected to prove their innocence in a system that has lost separation of powers and that has lost the independence of judiciary. We must also bear in mind, in my opinion, that Turkey in some ways resembles Russia. They both come from very strong state traditions. Once upon a time, they were both multi-ethnic, multilingual empires. So this dream of going back to the past, this golden age, imaginary golden age of grandeur, is very much alive in Turkey, just like it is very much alive in Russia. At the same time, I think we must not forget that the government and the people are not the same thing. So if we focus too much on Turkey's politics and politicians, we will get very, very depressed and demoralized. But when you talk to people, young people, women, minorities, people from very different backgrounds, it is amazing to see there are so many Democrats, liberals, progressives, dreamers, people who are globally connected under the harshest circumstances. We might not hear their voices, but they surely exist. And I think it's very important not to forget them. It's very important not to disconnect with them and to support them. Within that framework, I believe women occupy a very special place. For years, the existing political polarization also affected Turkey's women. And unfortunately, women have been divided into very rigid categories, unable to break bread together, share words together. But I believe when women are so badly divided, the only thing that benefits from this is patriarchy itself. So we need a new strong sisterhood that can transcend ideological boundaries and bring women from different backgrounds together. Because I think when societies go backwards and when they tumble down into fanaticism and authoritarianism, we women have much more to lose than men. So there's an urgency for us to come together, and perhaps the new impetus for a better democracy in Turkey is going to come from Turkey's women, women of all backgrounds, Turkish, Kurdish, Alevi, Armenian, Jewish. We need to revive that kind of feminism and women's movement that is all embracing and that goes hand in hand with the LGBT movement. Once, as a nation in Turkey, we saw ourselves historically and categorically, culturally, as part of Europe. So when I look at our literary journeys as Turkish writers, we grew up reading French literature, Italian literature, English literature, in addition to Russian literature. It's very interesting that Persian and Arabic literature has not been translated into Turkish until recently. That's a mistake for sure, but it's also a sign that shows that the country's literati saw themselves as part of Europe and not as part of the Middle East. Now, that mood has completely changed in Turkey. The dominant mood right now is Euroscepticism. And Turkey's political elites are telling the young people that, you know what, we tried, it didn't work. It's better to abandon the dream of EU, and it's better to think about other alternatives. The other alternatives that they're talking about include the Shanghai Pact. So they're saying we should join Kyrgyzstan, Turkmenistan, China, and Russia, and have an alternative pact there. And that's an easier place, of course, for a country with a sad record of human rights. But I think there are people overall, both inside Turkey and outside Turkey, who will claim, including some experts, who will claim that maybe democracy is not the right form, not the right regime for the Middle East. They are telling us that it doesn't work in this part of the world. And they're also saying maybe we have to make a choice between stability and democracy. And they're saying we have to prioritize stability over democracy. And I think people who believe in this false dichotomy have learned nothing from history. Because history has shown us time and again that undemocratic nations are very unhappy nations. And unhappy nations cannot possibly be stable in the long run. So I spoke about Turkey, but I also have been watching what's happening in the world, in Europe and in America, with a weird sense of déjà vu. Because some of the things that we see elsewhere weirdly resemble what happened in Turkey before. So the patterns feel strangely familiar. For instance, the sharp polarization in societies around false divisions of us versus them, the blurring of the line between fact and fiction, the reinvention of the past as an age of grandeur, and this rhetoric about making our countries great again, the emphasis on strong leadership, the fragility of liberal democracy in the hands of populist demagogues, and the attack against intellectuals, and this romanticization of an imaginary Volk, this emphasis on so-called real people, as if there could be an unreal people. Poland, Hungary, very much resembling what happened in Turkey before, but also to a certain degree, the movements in the Netherlands, in France. It is as if there's a template and we see this being repeated again and again. So what I'm trying to say is the loss of democracy in Turkey holds important lessons for progressives everywhere. What happened in my country can happen anywhere. It can even happen here. There are three elements, in my opinion, to take into consideration. Firstly, populist movements have a disproportionate impact on mainstream politics. Even when they stay in opposition, once they are in the game, they force mainstream politicians to adopt a much more nationalistic, jingoistic rhetoric. For instance, like we've seen in the Netherlands, when they come to power, secondly, they benefit enormously from manipulating state apparatus and also controlling the media. I think this is an age in which journalism is under attack. And thirdly, unlike, even though they like to claim that they are very nationalistic, in today's globalized age, I think all populist movements are deeply interconnected and they encourage each other, they feed each other. So what do we do? I think we need to understand that conventional politics in the form of left versus right is no more. There are new dividing lines that we need to take into consideration, including the duality between urban and countryside, such as we've seen in Austria or we have seen in Turkey in the latest referendum. These new divisions require a new and an all-embracing approach that can go beyond party politics and partisanship. I think we need to find a new language that also speaks to people's emotions. Emotions have been very much underestimated in mainstream political theory, but they're very important for us storytellers. I think we need to put more emotional intelligence on the table, because this is the age in which emotions guide, shape, and distort politics. When I say emotions, it's the age of angst, the age of apprehension, and the age of anger. If we only speak to people who think like us, vote like us, talk like us, I think that means we're staying in our own mental ghettos. And it is a very dangerous thing to be surrounded by tribes or to be surrounded by sameness. So in conclusion, I like to remind ourselves of what the Lebanese thinker and philosopher Khalil Gibran used to say. He used to say that in his life he had some unwanted teachers and he learned silence from people who were talkative. He used to say that he learned tolerance from the intolerant and kindness from the unkind. I think it's a beautiful way of thinking, and maybe we need to apply the same method. So we will learn the indispensability of democracy from autocrats. We will learn the beauty of pluralism from ultranationalists. We will learn the need for internationalism from isolationists. Therefore, allow me to go back and correct me, and allow me to correct what I said at the very beginning. I think it's not only Turkish or Nigerian or Egyptian writers. It is all of us, East and West, whatever our profession, from whichever walk of life we come from. We all need to become activists in this age, in my opinion. We need to become activists for empathy, for diversity, for pluralistic democracy, and very importantly, I think, for a global solidarity. Thank you.